Autocrafters, your source for Cougar, Falcon, Fairlane, Full-Size, Mustang, Maverick, Pinto, Ford Truck. Contact us at www.autocrafters.com.
All right, this week on Manic Mechanic, we're going to be going in and putting a radio in our 1972 Ford F-100 that we got from the guys at Autocrafters through RetroSound. RetroSound does all kind of radios, but I'm going to go over that once I get over to the tabletop. And we're also going to be putting a set of RetroSound speakers within the truck as well. So all that's going to be going on. Hopefully, we can get all that done in this one episode. All right, so one of the first things you want to do when you're working on electrical stuff on the truck or car is to disconnect the battery and set the negative cable off to one side so it's not contacting anything. That way you don't have a problem with possibly shorting something out in the radio when you're doing the install, because believe me, as tight as this truck chassis is now, there ain't a whole lot of room to move. Okay, so our radio that we're putting in our F-100 truck is from RetroSound. It's the one we got through the guys at Autocrafters. They have a specific part number available now for the 68 to 72 Ford F-100s. What I'm going to do now, though, is I'm going to kind of sift down through that and talk to you about how the radio comes. When it comes in the boxes, this is what you get. You have a faceplate that is separated, and you have what they call a motor, which is the box part of the radio that has all the wiring on it. The reason that RetroSound does this is that they are a radio company that's services tons of different models. They do everything from radios for Dodges, which from the 1960s and 70s were kind of an odd looking affair with dials that were basically vertical dials, out to the Wonder Bar radios that were in the Chevrolet products. So they have to cover a lot of ground, and in covering that a lot of ground, they have to have a way to do that inexpensively for them. Their solution was to do what we have here on the table. The Ford truck will use what they call a Long Beach face. This is the Long Beach, and it has this bezel, and this bezel will fit inside of the stock Ford trim bezel that goes on the dash panel of our F-100. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about what the rest of this is, and then we'll show you how to assemble your radio to put it in the truck. The radio, at least the Model 4, has a lot of nice connections on it. It has a Sirius input on it. This is really cool because if you have Sirius or XM in one of your vehicles, you can just basically port that over to your classic car and use it in the classic car. The Model 4 is also set up for using an iPod or an iPad, even an iPhone, and it will also charge those devices through the radio, which is really cool to have that ability. Now, you don't necessarily get that on all the models. The 4 is the one that has every one of the cool features that RetroSound offers on their radios. All right, in talking about this, I'm going to break out what this radio has as opposed to the Hermosa radio that Autocrafters also stocks from RetroSound. Now, this is the Mac Daddy. This has everything you could possibly want on it. One of the things that is different between the two radios is the fact that the Hermosa radio that Autocrafters sells does not have the second USB port. It only has a single USB. It is also not Sirius XM compatible like the Model 4 is. This radio is set up if you want to run your Sirius radio or your XM radio. You have an input for it here. The Hermosa radio that they offer does not. Now, both of those radios do have a subwoofer output. The nice thing about this is that a lot of this stuff is run with RCA jacks, making it really easy to set up. I like the fact that they're completely capped so that you don't have to worry about any kind of shorts or connections to the chassis accidentally when you're running the system. And I like this about the RetroSound radios as well. Their radios are all modular. Everything plugs into everything else. If you wanted to add a subwoofer on down the line with their system, you can do that. And they offer a nice big flat subwoofer that will fit in pretty much any chassis. Would fit in our truck underneath the seat, except for the fact that I added a late model F-150 seat to the truck. So we're not going to be putting a subwoofer or even an amp in the truck right now. I wanted to show you how to basically install a stereo in these trucks. Another thing is they have two auxiliary inputs. Basically, this is to allow you to run any kind of sound device that you got. You can also play your music from your phone through the Bluetooth system. The nice thing about this one is it is a completely hands-free radio. You can run your phone through your system and use the supplied microphone to be able to make calls and receive calls directly through the radio. A lot of states now are going to hands-free operation in your vehicles. It's going to matter just as much in a classic car as it's going to matter in a new car. I know a lot of you guys are going to say, I don't really care about getting phone calls while I'm driving my classic car. If I'm in that car, I don't want to hear from anybody. I get you. But if you want to, you can. Now, obviously, it has a radio aerial location that you can put the radio aerial on the car. And then you have your plug for your external mic, which I just showed you. And it has these line outs. Basically, this is to allow you to hook up your stuff through a preamp for and use the RCA jacks for that, basically going out to an amplifier and then coming back into the system. This allows you to hook that up for your front and rear amplification of the system. Comes with all the connections to hook up your speakers and to hook your power to your unit up. And all the wiring is here. You have everything you need to hook up for your constant 12, your switched 12, your ground. This is actually the power wire that goes from the radio out to your subwoofer or your amp. This one is for a power antenna if you so choose to put one on the vehicle. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of set everything else aside, and I am going to basically set up my radio in a loose configuration so we can take it over, fit it into the truck, and actually get all of this working nicely so it'll sit well on a radio faceplate inside the dash of the truck. And then we can be one step closer to putting this thing back on the street. All right, now the radio, as I said before, you have the motor and then you have the faceplate. And basically, the faceplate can fit on in either direction. It doesn't have a specific way it has to go as far as I can tell in putting them together. First, you want to go ahead and hook up your electrical connection. Make sure you got a good, nice, tight fit. Wrap that back in on itself a little bit. And then slide this in here. And you have four incredibly tiny screws. Don't lose them, because they're really hard to find. Don't ask me how I know. These four will need to be put into the into the radio faceplate. Almost lost that one. I'm going to finish these up off camera because, you know, it's four screws. You saw how the faceplate goes on. When this is all done, then we'll start talking about mounting the actual side plates on the sides of the radio. Okay, we have the brackets. Now, these brackets are marked right and left. And so I'm going to start off with the left since it's facing up in the air right now. Now, through me putting this thing together once already, I know that the actual bracket needs to go on here very far back, basically at the very end of the tabs. Now, I will say this. These brackets are from the older radios. They have since changed the way these mounting brackets are done, so this may not quite be the case on the newer stuff that you guys are going to be getting. But on this particular radio, because we got this radio a while back and just didn't have enough of a good time to put it in before. And I've noticed in the photographs that the radios now have slightly different mounting brackets. Get these in. Now on the F100 with this particular bracket, you're going to have to set it up so that these are sitting right at the very back edge. You don't want to go all the way tight on these things. And these are also set into a rubber mounting, so it kind of cushions this against a lot of shock. But you want to get these to pull down a little bit, like you do. Then you have, these are your knob sets, and that's the cool thing again about this radio. You can mount these things anywhere you want. You could take and get an extension lead for this. It's basically almost like a phone style plug, and that goes in here. And then this goes through the center one for a Ford F100 application. And I'm going to go ahead and put a washer on both sides. I'm going to put a washer on the back and a washer on the front after I get it installed on here. And the nuts are half inch nuts, and you install the nut on top of here. Now you'll also have an additional one that goes on as well. Now I don't know that this is the actual location where this is going to need to sit. This may need to move to a different spot. I'll try to pull that out a little bit. I already had one of the nuts installed on here, because you will have to monkey about with this just a little bit to get them to sit in the right location on the dash panel itself. because you don't want the radio to sit too deep or too narrow. And I'm just going to hand tighten those right now. Now off camera, I'm going to go ahead and install the right hand side, and then we'll be ready to try to put this in the dash. Again, as I said, you want to keep this really loose so that you can rock that back and forth to get it to go through the actual plates on your dash, if you're lucky enough for those to still be there. All right, upon further review, I've decided that you can actually do a lot better job of setting this thing up if you actually have the radio bezel. One thing I will say that I didn't mention before is if your bezel is missing from your truck, you can get the bezel from the guys at AutoCrafter. They do stock this one now. So if yours is really jacked up and the holes are all bored out, you can replace it to put that with your RetroSound radio. Now what you'll want to do is, I've already kind of set these on. They're a little loose so they can be moved back and forth, but they're not so loose that they're flopping around on the radio itself. And I'm going to go in and try to line all of this up and get everything close as I can get it. And I want to try to center these up in the opening. And the other thing I'm going to try to do is this. I'm going to make sure when I'm putting this together that when I put the knobs on there, like this knob, this backing knob here, that the knob itself doesn't stick out too far from the faceplate of the radio. On the Ford trucks, the radio knobs always looked a little odd to me because these bezels were really huge. These are nice ones. We went and ordered a different set directly from the guys at RetroSound. These are actually the 2987s. Now, when RetroSound does their knobs and it says it's a 2987, what that means is that this is your 29 knob and this is your 87 knob. And you can call them up and order a custom set of knobs if you desire. The ones that actually come with the radio from the guys at AutoCrafters will work in a Ford. They are actually Ford-style knobs, but on a 68 to 72 Ford pickup truck, they are not actually correct. These are actually much more correct, and you can get them, like I said, directly from the guys at RetroSound at this point. Contact the folks at AutoCrafters. They may be able to go ahead and get that for you with the radio, but check with them first, and then if you can't get them through AutoCrafters, contact the guys at RetroSound and they can set you up with that. So what I want to do is I want to put both of those on to check position and depth. They are tabbed so that they go on in only a certain location. And then what you'll want to do is, while that's in there, you want to make sure that that's centered up in the hole. You're going to take your half inch wrench and tighten this up to the back plate there. And I always try to get these things to where they're sitting pretty much vertically. Now, then your radio is basically ready to go, and I'm gonna go ahead and pull these back off because in order to install the radio in the truck, you're gonna need to take the faceplate and the knobs back off of it. These don't exactly look like the original knobs, but they do mimic it well enough that I think most people looking inside the truck won't notice what we got going on here. And there you go. Now we have the radio in. We just need to work on getting the hookups made for our dash speaker up on top. And we need to make our hookups for the speakers down inside the kick panels. I've decided that that's where they're going to go. I've got rust out down there. It's a perfect time to cut the rust out and put speakers in. At least that's my excuse for doing what I'm doing, because I don't want to fix the rust. I'm going to put my speakers down there to keep from having to work that. All right, folks, that's all we have time for this week. Next week, we're going to be coming back and finishing this thing up. We're going to be putting our speakers in, talking about products from the guys at Rhino Fabrication, and we're going to just go ahead and even let you hear how it sounds, even though through my mic, as good as my mic is, it's not going to sound as good as it will to your ears sitting in a completed truck. It's going to be real tinny sounding because of what we got going on. We'll go over all that next week. You guys have a great week. We'll see you on down the road.